Good morning, church. Good to see all your faces here and those who are at home. We know you're there. If you're able, would you please stand with us? This is the time to worship right now. We're going to lift our voices and praise to Him.
Father God, we humbly come before you, Lord, first giving you glory, honor, and praise and saying thank you, Jesus. God, we thank you for your amazing grace and your presence this morning, oh God, in this temple, Lord. Father, we pray for those who are hurting right now, God. We pray for the families, Father God. I'm going to tell you this morning, oh God, we pray for her friend, Father God, who's in the hospital, God. We ask that you cover them this morning, God, with your grace and your blood, oh God. Father, we don't know why things happen the way they do, but we know that we trust in your holy name, oh God. So, Father, this morning we give you glory, honor, and praise and say thank you for another day, God, and thank you for hearing us this morning as we give you all glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Souls of man, oh, you rescue. Oh,
serve a great God who gives amazing grace. Grace we can never earn it. Sometimes we think we can and we try, and then it makes us feel worse. But His grace is free. We just pick it up. He gives it to us and we accept it. It is amazing, isn't it?
Amazing grace. I do believe all of us, when we sing this amazing grace, amazing grace, how sweet the sound. We think about God and what Paul said. Paul said his grace is sufficient. God's grace is sufficient. Especially during these days, we can see what we can think about what Paul wanted to say when he said God's grace is sufficient. I've been praying, I do believe that the Church of Jesus, our church, I've been praying for Natalia's family. We have been praying for Lourdes. Maybe some of you saw the picture, you know who they are. But Lourdes, but Natalia worked in this church for years. She used to clean the bathroom, the pastor's office, the whole church. And I have good memories. Because usually on Saturdays when I used to come to the church to do something, Natalia used to be here, and many times she used to have something on her hands. Was a jar, it's like a fresh with, I don't know, it's not a perfume, but it's like something that you spray the church. And what the name is? Yeah, okay, fresh air. And she said, Pastor, I bought this for the church. And I asked her, why you didn't ask the church, because we have in our budget money available for this? She said, no, I want to buy that and bring to the church, because God's church deserves the best. I want my pastor's office to have a good aroma. Been in this church for now 10 years. I have a good idea about people who they are. I know you, and I know your heart. I knew Natalia. She always used to say, Pastor, I love you, and I knew that. With Lourdes, they used to sit down close to where Roy is during the Portuguese speaking service. Lourdes is in the hospital. She broke a vertebra. And she needs our prayers. They were always together. Wherever you see Lourdes, you would see Natalia. One thing that we learn from Lourdes, and we know when we start to work with the buildings, she said, and after we had the COVID-19, we have all these problems. She said to me, Pastor, I started already to sell some stuff, and part of the money goes towards the building. I already start to put something together. Many times she had something to do to bring to the pastors, and she used to say, I'm sending Natalia. I miss her. I was talking to Pastor Orlando, and he said to me, when I do something, always Natalia's in my thoughts. What a special woman she was. As God's family that we are, I want you to pray for Eunice, Puka, the Pyrus family. They need our prayers. The funeral will be here Saturday at 11 p.m. 11 a.m. But I want the church to continue to pray for the family, especially for the father. And pray for the service that we will have. Pray for God's church. Let us pray. Father, we want to thank you for the good legacy that Natalia left to us. A woman who fears the Lord. She had a desire to please you. And I saw through her lifestyle, her behavior, that she was really a woman of God. She's not here with us, but she's with you. But as the family of faith, we miss her so bad. May you continue to comfort your church, all of us who knew Natalia. We pray, Lord, also for Lourdes in the hospital. Touch her body, Lord, heal her. Not only physically, but also emotionally. We pray for the family of Natalia. Be with them. Continue to comfort their hearts. Continue to take care of your church, Father. We want to thank you because we know that you are the one who always will continue to guide us and to bless us. Bless us. It's so good to see our sister Jamie here with us today. I pray for her. I pray for her faith. May you continue to bless this couple. Bless their children. Help us, Father, to continue to trust you. Everything, Lord, that we do or say, I pray that your name be glorified. Help us, Lord. Help us. Because without you, we are hopeless. Guide us, bless your church. I pray for the elders of the church. May you continue to take care of them. You know, all of them. And I pray, Lord, in everything that we do or say, help us to honor and glorify your holy name. I pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Another angel made it home. God bless her family. Thank you, Father. mic as well, please? This morning, I'm going to start with a scripture this morning, and it's about God delivering us from all that we need. This morning, Psalms 119, verse 170 says, "Let my supplication come before you," which is my humble prayer. "Deliver me according to your word." So this morning, my question to you is, have you ever failed before? Have you ever attempted to do something your way, and in the end, you had to cry out for God to take care of it because your way was the wrong way? So when we come to God, no matter what we desire or need at that time of refreshing, we say, "God, forgive me. God, deliver me. God, save me from myself. God, in all things great and small, you can fix this. I can't fix it." Situations that we can't control, things that we just don't know. Sometimes we don't know what we're doing, but we trust in him because he says, "I will deliver you from all things. When you come to me with a humble heart," that means not arrogantly, but "seek my face at my feet, I will deliver you." That's his promise. Has he ever been unfaithful to you? Has he ever forgotten you? He will deliver you. Amen.
Deep as the ocean, right as the rain, this powerful emotion lifts me up above the plains. It's taken me to places I never thought I'd go, showing me a grace I never thought I'd know. When I feel like I can't go on, you deliver me. When the road is winding and way too long, you deliver me. You deliver me.
Best part.
Oh, I feel like a sinner whose sins have been washed clean. An absolute beginning this heart has never seen. I must be forgiven for sometimes asking why I was chosen to be given you. Too long, you deliver me.
blessing to see Paul today. Good surprise. You know, Father, God bless you. And see all the people. Amen. Open to do what God wants them to do. It's a blessing. Again, Jimmy, it's good to see you with us today. God bless you and bless Hervé. Thank God for Hervé today. I think I messed up something in the office, but he was there with a patient to solve that problem, and he did that. Thank you, Hervé, for your willing to serve God and to do what God wants us to do. Let us continue to pray for one another. I want to pray for someone today. Always, these past weeks, I see her coming to the altar. I'm not able to approach and touch her and pray over her. But I would like to pray for Irish before I read the word of God. Father, I want to thank you for all your people. But I also want to pray especially for my sister Irish. You know her heart, you know what she's going through, but she trusts you. And we know that you can do great things. Nothing is impossible for you. Be with her, give her the peace to know that you are in control. And help us, Lord, to continue to pray for one another. Again, bless your church. Bless us. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you, Irish. Been praying for you. Let us open our Bible in 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 16 to 20. I'm going to talk about legacy. Maybe some of you heard this message, not in the church, but the message that I had yesterday to preach was about Jesus, God being Jehovah Nissi. God is our banner. But this morning God spoke with me, and I want to challenge God's church as we think about legacy to question ourselves, what kind of legacy are we leaving behind? What kind of legacy? We are called to touch someone else. We are called to do something that can be meaningful to people. The Word of God, of course, tells us that as human beings, as Christians, we are called first to glorify Jesus, God, through His Son Jesus. As you eat, drink, or do something else, make sure that you are bringing honor and glory to the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let us open our Bible, 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verses 16 to 20. 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verses 60 to 20. Amen. 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 16. Jeremy, God bless you. He's doing a great job, you know, helping. It's good to see our youth involved, and also those who are Jessica, also Junior, Juliana, Tammy, helping. We praise God for what you are doing. Let us open. Read our Bible, 2 Chronicles chapter 21, verse 16 to 20. Amen. The Word of God says, "The Lord arose against Jehoram, the hostility of the Philistines and the Arabs who lived near to Cushites. They attacked Judah, invaded it, and carried off all the goods found in the king's palace, together with his sons and wives. Not a son was left to him except Azariah, the youngest. After all this, the Lord afflicted Jehoram with an incurable disease of the bones. In the course of the time, at the end of the second year, his bones came out because of the disease, and he died in great pain. His people made no funeral fire in honor as they had for his predecessors. Jehoram was 32 years old when he became a king, and he reigned in Jerusalem 8 years. He passed away to no one's regret and was buried in the city of David, but not in the tombs of the kings. Father, use your word. Talk to us in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. There are facts in our lives, people, things that happened, that passed and left their marks, stories, and memories forever. I saw something on Facebook. It was a kid running away from a lady. She had a stick in her hands. And when I saw that, like my mind went back for my first day when I went to school. First day. My mother brought me to the school and the teacher was at the door. In those days, she had in her hand a stick and she was welcoming all the students. Oh my, that was a nightmare. Huh? Can you imagine you go to school and the first day that you go to the class and the teacher has a stick in her hand. And my mother say hello to the teacher. The teacher welcome me. What's your name? Amir. Okay, you can come. And inside I was. And she said to my mother, goodbye. My mother said, bye. She said, don't worry, he's going to be safe. And as my mother turned away and left, I ran, calling my mother. She said to my mother, don't worry, you can go. And she ran against me and grabbed me and bring me into the class. And I was petrified. That was a nightmare. My first years in the school, I didn't pass. I remember those days when my mother would call me in the morning, time to go work. I used to do this. I never forgot. She used to question me, what's going on? I said, I don't feel good. I have a problem in my throat. She asked me, you want to stay home? I said, yes, 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 yes. I enjoyed to stay home in those days. It's not like today that Ben is in the school, have a school class in home, and he said it's the best school ever. The reason was that I didn't like to go to school. In that class, there was like a big wall in the middle of that classroom. And when I go to the classroom, I want to make sure that nobody would to sit down in a chair that was there. Because my teacher used to sit down this side, and I used to run and be quiet. In those days, I didn't know how to pray, but I was there. Hope that she's not going to call me to teach me. She used to have some sweet stuff. She had a good heart. And she used to, if you don't have money, she used to cut the we call sucrinha. And she used to give to the student who didn't have money. I used to go there and took my sucrinha and I never forgot. Even today, I can see the teacher, the class, I can have a good vision of the class of the where I went. Memories forever. Parents, grandparents, uncles, brothers, teachers, classmates, pastors, who did something, and even though those things happened many years ago, they continue to be in our memories as a mark. If I would give you a chance to tell me something, stories that happened in the past when you were a kid, you tell me something that caught your attention. All of us remember those things. They are like marks in our memory. But we have been placed in the world, my brothers and sisters, dear friends, for a specific purpose. According to the word of God, we are here to honor and glorify God. We are placed on earth to bring honor and glory to God. Wherever we go, or whatever we say, make sure that we are honoring, praising God with our behavior. Yes, my brothers and sisters, there is a question that all of us need to ask. Why do so many people do not leave a positive mark? Because I'm talking about legacy. What kind of legacy are we going to leave for the next generation? And the question is, why do so many leave a negative trial, a stain, a crime, a negative name, thief, killer, abuser? But thank God, there are others that go through life and leave names recorded for posterity, for others to see and make honorable mention of, because they left a good legacy. Legacy is about life and living. It is about learning from the past, living in the present, and building for the future. Jim Rohn wrote, "All good men and women must take a responsibility to create legacies that will take the next generation to a level we could only imagine." Sharon Alder wrote, "Carve your name on hearts, not tombstones. A legacy is etched into the minds of others and the stories they share about you." Legacy is fundamental to what it is to be human. Research shows that without a sense of working to create a legacy, adults lose meaning in their life. Exploring the idea of legacy offers a glimpse not only into human relationships and building strong communities, but also the human spirit. The idea of legacy may remind us of that, but it is not about that. Being reminded of that is actually a good thing, because that informs life. We know this. We are all in the invisible road of death, but we do not know when our day will be. Legacy also gives you a perspective of what is important. But legacy is really about life and living. It helps us decide the kind of life we want to live and the kind of world we want to live in. Galileo was willing to challenge the orthodoxy of the church through his own scientific discoveries. He left a great legacy. Helen Keller overcame the dual disability of deaf blindness to champion the deaf and help improve society's treatment of deaf people. Thomas Edison left his legacy of the invention of the light bulb, microphone, and other things. Albert Einstein was a man who reworked the laws of physicians. Physics campaigned for international peace, and even though we know that he faced great failures in her personal life. We all know Nelson Mandela. He left us an incredible legacy of reconciliation, freedom, and equality. Mandela also left us a positive legacy to improve the world. Martin Luther King also left a good legacy. At 33, he was pressing the case of civil rights with the President John Kennedy. At 34, he galvanized the nation with his "I Have a Dream" speech. At 35, he won the Nobel Peace Prize. At 39, he was assassinated, but he left a legacy of hope and inspiration that continues today. When we look at the Bible, to the gallery of heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, we see the names of some people who left a legacy of faith. And because of that, they became a good example for us as Christians. In the chapter 11, verse 5, we read, "By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God has taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as the one who pleased God." He was commended as the one who pleased God. Great legacy for all of us as Christians. We think about Noah. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. In holy fear, he built an ark. He obeyed God even when he could not understand. Great legacy for all of us. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went even though he did not know where he was going. I always, when I think about Abraham, I think about GPS. God spoke with him, "Go to a place that I'm going to show you." And in obedience, by faith, he left his hometown. And by faith, he went to a place that he didn't know what direction to take. The only thing that he knew, that it was important for him to be open for God's direction. Legacy. What kind of legacy are we going to leave behind? In the book of Acts, we read about people who were not even mentioned by names, but were decisive for the start of the early church. Names, people who we never have their names mentioned, but we know today through the word of God that they did something that touched someone's life, that made those people who didn't know Christ to approach Jesus. And one of those things that we know from this people, group of people, is that they loved one another. They were together. The word of God says when the beginning church started, when after Pentecost, when after Peter's preaching, when more than 2,000 people accept Jesus as their personal Savior, people start to go to those meetings, and the word of God says every day, people who had been saved. And the reason was because they saw the way that the church, people from the church were living. What kind of legacy we International Church of Nazarene are leaving into our community. One thing that it's important for us to understand is legacy is not only about great things that we need to do, like Abraham Lincoln, or we can think about Mandela, but it is small things that also we do with all our hearts, like that woman who went to the house of Simon the leper and anointed Jesus. And Jesus said, what she did will be reminded. Things that maybe she never thought that would make a positive impact in the save, in the life, in the savers, savior of the world. Thought. The one who created us said what she did would be reminded, remembered. My brothers and sisters, the text that we already read talks about the king Jehoram, who reigned 8 years and did evil things during his time when he was king in Judah. He brought the people of Judah to idolatry and did not listen to the rebuke of Elijah. For this reason, he died alone. When the people of Judah heard that Jehoram was very ill, no one complained. No one prayed for him. They didn't like him. They didn't care about him because he left a bad legacy. Nobody complained. What kind of legacy? Natalia left a good legacy to the Church of Jesus and to the community here in New Bedford, for those who knew Natalia. For some of you who had the opportunity to be close to her, you would learn from someone who was gentle, humble heart, and who wanted to praise God. Her favorite song was "All to Jesus, I Surrender." I surrender all. Tudo entregarei. And I could see a woman who wanted to please God, who wanted to do what God wanted her to do. Eunice called me Friday, her sister, and she said, "Pastor, I'm calling you because I would like to have a Bible verse to use in those cards. What verse that you'd suggest?" Automatically, I said to her, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and share your master's happiness." I didn't have time to say, I didn't say to her, "Let me think about." But the verse came to my mind, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and share your master's happiness." Natalia was faithful. She was faithful. She didn't do great things as when we think about teaching Sunday school, like having a ministry like our brother Steve Dutton. She didn't know how to teach the Word of God to someone else. But her life was a testimony of someone who wants to please God. Legacy. I will miss Natalia. She always said, always, coming to the church when she said, "Pastor, I love you. You know that I love you." Not only to say, but to show. And Elizabeth said to me, I do not believe, Pastor Orlando, and many of you, there are things that only one day we are going to ask God. I spoke during the Portuguese speaking service. People who know her better because she used to be more for the Portuguese-speaking service. I said, this is time for us to lament. Because usually as a Christian, we say, oh, God is with us, everything is. And that is something that really is not in the Bible. Do you know that there is a lot of psalms in the Bible that are called psalms of lament? People that approach God and say, God, why you did this to me? God, why? I don't understand. Why you did this to me? Driving my car many times, now I'm going, saying, God, why? And sometimes I say to myself, Natalia, why? Why? There is moment, there is time for us as Christians to approach God with the wise. Why this is happening? I'm being faithful, Lord. I'm trying to do my best. But why, Lord God, why? But in all the Psalms of Lament, there is a moment that the psalmist stops. He said, God, even I, when I do not understand the wise, I keep trusting you. I keep trusting you. My brother and sister, may God comfort us. And during these days that we are going through times of sadness, the moment I stop, I feel the tears coming down. Elizabeth sometimes home and crying. Many of you, we question why. But at the same time, we like Job. We say to ourselves, I know my Redeemer lives. I know my Redeemer lives. Question that one day we are going to ask God. But that day, I do believe when we got there, when I see Natalia, those questions will disappear. You know, because God has the best for us. We do not understand. I want to challenge you, my brothers and sisters, and especially dear friends, to more than to work to leave a good legacy that is very important, to make sure that your life is in God's hands. That you have accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Yes, more important than to leave a good legacy, which is very important, is to have our life in God's hands, who can take care of us. May God bless us. May God help us during these days that are really difficult. 2020 is we see a lot of waves coming in different directions. But it's good to know that God is with us. May God continue to bless us, to comfort God's church. The funeral will be Saturday at 11 a.m., like I said. And I want us to keep praying for our sisters, Puka and Eunice. They are the Pirates family. They were members in this church for many, many years. I think since they came to the United States, they have been members of this church. I ask you to pray for Natalia's father. He is now in Fogo, Senhor Elvídio, and for the whole family. Let us also keep our sister Lourdes in our prayers and thoughts. She's still in the hospital in Rhode Island, and she... It's much better now. She's stable, but I want the church to continue to pray for her. Amen. God bless you, and God continue to take care of His church and to help us in everything that we do or say to honor Him, but make sure that we can leave a good legacy for those who are going to come after us. They will see that we fear God. And also we live a kind of life that touch other people. And God was honored through us. Amen. Let us stand and we are going to pray. I'm going to ask my brother, Roy, can you pray for us today?
Precious Father, we thank thee for this service today, Father, Lord. And may we always remember, Lord, it is important to leave a legacy just like you did, Father, Lord, an everlasting legacy that will last through all eternity, Lord. Now, Father, as we go here, Father, Lord, I pray, Lord, that we will always have a thirst for righteousness, a thirst for peace, Amen. A thirst for righteousness, Father, Lord. But above all, Lord, may we have a hunger for holiness. Oh, yes. Without holiness, Lord, it is impossible to see God. Mm. So, Father, bless us as we go out. Give us traveling mercies as we go our separate ways, Lord. And these things we ask, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Let us receive the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Go in peace. Have a blessed week in his presence. Amen.